Hello again. Going to work on some exercises in lesson 17 together in your intermediate logic book. I would like you to first turn to page 124 and let's do this one together. Now take a look at it. It says, if U then W, if U then W, not if U then X, therefore W. All right, and we have a few more lines to solve it, up to 7, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right, now the first thing that you should see here is in order to get this conclusion, in order to conclude W, we could use this. If U, then W. Somehow, if we get U by itself here, that will imply W. So there's a good possibility, and the best way to do it, I believe, to prove it. So to get U by itself, we can't use the W yet. We can only use the premises we have. So if U then W and not if U then X. It looks like we're going to have to change one of these. Now we don't want to keep the X. So having it as an if then is a problem. So let's change that. Let's get rid of our if then. And what can we get, how can we begin to get rid of our X? Well, we can change it by implication to an or. We would negate the first one and change it to an or. So we would negate the U and make it or X. But you still can't get rid of the X that way, but you're a step closer. Because remember, in simplification, we can get rid of the second one. So we need to get this into an and X, or an and not X or something, but we need to get rid of that X. But we can't go right from an if-then to an and. But we can go from an if-then to an or to an and. And this is where you have to think ahead like a chess player. So let's take a look at it. Okay, so if we do use implication for that intermediate step, then it would look like not, it was before, that was there before. So what I'm changing is I'm negating the U, the first constant in this, changing the if-then to an or, the conditional to a disjunction, and X, okay? And that was using line 2 and performing a material implication on it, changing if then to an or. All right, now the next thing we need to do, because we still want to get rid of the X, we need to change it to an and. Now if you look in the back of your book, you can see the way to change a disjunction into a conjunction is with De Morgan's. So let's do that. If you look in the back of your book at how, we're going to just do line 3 and do a De Morgan's on it. Give you a second. Do you know how to transfer? Okay, this will have to carry down too. Do you know how to transfer this to a De Morgan's? What will it look like? I'll give you a second to think about it. See if you can guess. All right, or no. Not U and not X is what it should look like. Okay? This is not a neither anymore. It is a not and. You've changed a neither to a not and. Okay, line 5. Now, you see this is a not you? That's good, because we want to get to just you by itself to imply W. But this not X is unnecessary, so let's get rid of it. I think we can get rid of it safely now. And take line 4 and do a simplification. And let's just say not you. Now remember, every step has to be shown. You can't skip anything. You have to show all your work. So we have gotten rid of the and not X. We've simplified it. Now we have not you. The next thing to do is to change this so it means the same thing. We'll use a rule of replacement called double negation. And you probably were shouting that out before I even said it. And this becomes a you. Now we have what we need. We have implied you from using these rules of replacement. And now, if you, then W. You. Therefore, W. And we got that using lines 1 and 6. Oops, wrong line here. The double negation was from line 5. Okay. Lines 1 and 6. If you, then W. You. Therefore, W. You should be shouting it out. Modus ponens. Okay, and that is your solution for, this is number 8 on page 124 of your book, Intermediate Logic. So, quod erat demonstratum. We finished. We've proven it. Okay, the next one we're going to do. Now, as you're looking at these and trying to figure out what to use, think about what constants you need to keep. What constants you may need to add to be able to solve your proof. Think about what operators you need. If you have a different operator than what you want, then look in the back of your book at your appendix and see what you can use to change the operator. And those would be rules of replacement that you would use to change the operator. The rules of inference are not used to change operators. Those are actually just used to prove your logic, that it logically follows. Now you have a few in here that are not very logical in 17. And I'll talk to you about that in a little bit. But let's look at number 11. 11's kind of a long one. G or H, if G or H, then I. If J or K, then not I. K, therefore, not H. Okay, now I'm going to double check and make sure I have that down correctly. G or H, if G or H, then I. If J or K, then not I. K, therefore not H. All right. The most common mistake that people make in logic, I have found in the years I was teaching Challenge B, is that they would copy it wrong. It might be a wrong operator, or may leave off a negation, add a negation where it doesn't belong. And just like in math, if you make a simple mistake, like multiplying instead of dividing, or putting a wrong number, or an extra zero, or move your decimal place to the wrong spot, your answer is going to be completely wrong. You cannot get to the moon by being that much wrong. You have to be right. And you can't have a logical argument unless you cross your T's and dot your I's. Or mind your P's and Q's. Okay, so we're going to mind our P's and Q's. Line 4, what we're going to do here, what we need to do to get to not H, We've got a lot of work to do to get to not H. We don't have any way to assert these yet, but we could. We do have a K. Okay, so we have something to work with. We have J or K, and here's a K. If J or K, then not I. But we don't have the J here, so that's something we can do. We can work with that. Let's take the K and just add a J. K or J. And that's using line 3, addition. Now that we have that, what we want to do is flip them so that we can then have the implied not I. We want to try to use all our lines if possible. Well, we want to use all our lines. So we've got K or J. Now we're going to commute. We'll use the commutative law, commutation, and change this to J or K from line 4. Okay, I've used line 3 and 4. Next. What can we derive now? We've got J or K. If J or K, then not I. So we have not I. And that would be, if antecedent, then consequent. Antecedent, therefore consequent. That's modus ponens using lines 2 and 5. Okay, number 7. All right, what else can we do here? We've used line 2. We've used line 5. We've still got line 1. G or H. If G or H, then I. Not I.
Not I.
Okay. G, if G or H, then I. Not I. Denying this. So we can use modus tollens here. From line 1. And derive not G or H, not either G or H. Okay, I'm negating the whole thing. That's why I, remember this is a term, the whole term in the parentheses. So if I'm negating, if I negate the I, which I did, then I've got to negate all of this. So I'm not just negating the G, it's the whole thing. That's why I've left it in parentheses. I am negating the antecedent. All right. Now I have a neither nor situation here. And I want to get to not H. So to get to not H, so far I have a not either. And I want the not to be on the H. And it's got to be an and maybe switched. Think about that. What I still have to do to get this not H by itself. I've got an or. To simplify it, to get rid of the G, it's going to have to be an and it's going to have to be switched around so that the G is what I get rid of. So first things first, turning an or into an and will be De Morgan's. So this is a neither into a not both. De Morgan's. And using line 7 alone, I'm going to say not G or, wait, excuse me. That's the whole point of this. Not G and not H. Not both. Okay. Now that I have that, I still want my not H by itself. If I did a simplification now, I'd be getting rid of the one I want. So I'm going to have to do the commutation again. And I'll say not H and not G.
Now I can simplify and say not H. Simplify. Simplify 9. And I did a commutation of 8 here.
So let's see. Yes, I use line 1. 6, not I. I know I used that somewhere. I used that in my modus tollens.
So that was 1 and 6.
De Morgan's. Commutation. Okay. And then I simplified. And I am done. This, now that I've simplified it, the not H here is the same as this. I have proven it. I'm finished. Okay. So you see the process I was thinking through, that if you have an if-then and you need to get an and, you're going to have to go through a two-step process. Change an if-then to an or, then you can change an or to an and. Okay. And with other ones, you'll be doing the same thing as well. You may use an abs to change a double conditional to an if-then and an and. You could do all kinds of things with this, with the rules of replacement, to get them in the form you want, and that's the point. This is messy. Messy. Okay. So I want to give you some hints about number 12, and then we're going to move on. In exercise number 12, to end up with a not P and a not L, from what you have, somewhere, you're probably going to need to use a De Morgan's, somewhere, okay? You're going to need to do some simplifying and some joining. And somewhere in here, you're going to have, you're separating out the letters. You have to separate them out, so you'll have to have a not L by itself somewhere. You'll have to have a not M so that you can get a not P. Because if you look at line number 2, it says, if P, then M. Somewhere along the line, you're going to need to get a not M to get a not P. So those are some clues for working through number 12. Now, in the second part here, on page 125, write out an English argument, not the whole proof, that could be symbolized by the given problems from this exercise. Do they sound valid? Why or why not? You don't have to use the letters they're using. For instance, it says, if A, therefore, if B, then A. You can just make up your own letters, make up your own thing. But it would be assertion, therefore, if antecedent and consequent. Okay. A, therefore, if B, then A. A, let's see. Elections are held every 4 years. That's an assertion. Therefore, if I brush my teeth, then elections are held every 4 years. It could be anything you want. The reason it could be anything you want is it's affirming the consequent. All right. There is not really any reason to just assert that B would lead to A. But, okay, and the next section, our number 14, take a look at it and see if it logically follows. Does it logically follow? And if not, why not? Is there a problem with it? You know, you can have fine-sounding arguments, and Scripture talks about being careful
of people with fine sounding arguments. Because just because they sound good, it doesn't mean they're right. And that's why this is important, and you need to understand these rules. And they could come across with this great argument, but if they're affirming the consequent, if they're denying the antecedent, if they are giving you unrelated things and stringing them together as though they belong together. It's an invalid argument. Their form is wrong. Even though it may sound like everything they're saying is right, the argument's not valid. And if they're trying to trick you, that might be something they're doing. So beware of fine-sounding arguments, things that are falsely called knowledge. You can also deny the premise. If you're listening to an argument that someone's making, and they're making an assertion that everything depends on this assertion being so, question that. Is that assertion true? Is it right? Because if everything else depends on their first premise being true, and it's not, their whole argument falls apart. Okay. If the conclusion does not necessarily follow from the premises, it's only a fine-sounding argument. And that's what, as believers, we're supposed to cast down. These imaginations, these fine-sounding arguments, anything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God and the truth. And we're all about the truth, okay? So let's take a look at exercise 17b, number 3. It gives you the constants H-A-I-G, the Hague. Well, that's not how they spell it. Okay, H-A-I-G. And let's work through this one together, and then you could do the others on your own. If Jesus both helped others and argued rationally, then he was not insane. You can hear those clue words there? The if, then, therefore. Okay? If the gospel accounts are true, then Jesus rationally argued and he helped others. Thus, or therefore, either the gospel accounts are false or Jesus was not insane. Okay? You hear the ifs, thens, therefores, the nots, the ands. It might help you to highlight those, and then you can write it out in proper form. Okay? If, and using H-A-I-G, these are what they gave you. So H is for helped others. Jesus helped others. A would be argued rationally. I would be insane. So not insane would be negated I. And thus either the gospel accounts are false, would be a not G. If they're false, it would be not G. So gospel. Gospel accounts are true would be G. Or Jesus was not insane would be not I. Okay, not insane. So it would look like this. If Jesus, wait, not J. If Jesus both helped others, it says both helped others and argued rationally, so this would be line one, then he was not insane. That's line one. Okay? Second premise. This is what it's asking you to do. You put it in symbolic speech and then you write it as you would a proof. Okay? Right. If the gospel accounts are true, then, wait, there's an and here. If the gospel accounts are true, then Jesus argued rationally and helped others. Thus, okay, this is the therefore. Therefore, either the gospel accounts are false, not G, or Jesus was not insane, not I. Let me just double check my work here. If Jesus helped others and argued rationally, he both did both, then he was not insane. If the gospel accounts are true, then Jesus argued rationally and he helped others. Thus,
either the gospel accounts are false or Jesus was not insane. All right. You notice here the truth value of this is the gospel is true. That's why it's just G. And here it's asserting the gospel is false, therefore it's negated G. Okay? They have opposite truth values. Now, to solve this one, let's take a look at it. What do we have here? We want to end up with not G or not I as our conclusion. So there's a G and there's an I. This would have to be changed into a not G. And here we have H and A, A and H. There's two if-thens. So if this was if P then Q, and this is another if R. Okay. I think the first thing I need to do that just looks obvious to me is I have H and A and I have A and H. I'm going to change this one. Now remember, you can have, if you're doing a rule of replacement, you can do it within a problem. I'm just going to change this around. So I'm going to leave the rest the same, but for line three, I'm going to say if G, then H and A, leave it in the parentheses. All I've done to line two is I have done commutation. That's it. I haven't changed the meaning. Now, I've used line two. I'm going to ignore it now. Now I have something that logically follows, but I'll go backwards to make it work. If G, then H and A. If H and A, then not I. Do you see it? It's the first two premises in a hypothetical syllogism. If G, then H and A. If H and A, then not I. So I can conclude if G, then not I. Okay, I have if G, then not I. What happens? Can I change this into an or and get this? Can I? Take a look in your book. This is an if-then. It's a conditional. I want to change it to a disjunction. And I want to negate only the first one.
Ah.
You see it? Material implication, IMPL. Oh, wait a minute. This was hypothetical syllogism using three, then one in that order. Okay, you got to write your proofs on the right line. All right. So I'm going to change this using implication. From line four into not G or not I. You'll notice it matches. We're done. Yay! Okay, so that's basically what you're supposed to do with the last section. There's a couple more here to do. Whoa, several more to do. But that gives you how to go about it. And I will work on lesson 18 and 19 next and get those up soon. This may be the last video I make in this particular series. I don't think I will do the truth trees or proving rules unnecessary. Those are interesting. I don't think they're as difficult, frankly. But I do recommend. Jim Nance has come out with, it was unavailable for a while, and it's actually kind of hard to find. The Intermediate Logic has a new video, and you can get the last chapters in that, and you can, and he's, oh my goodness, he's such a wonderful teacher. I really recommend that
go to Rainbow Resources has, I think it's $45 for the set of intermediate logic. So it's a lot less expensive. And then you can look through the last section with him instructing, and he's a far better teacher than I could be. And I wish you a wonderful semester, rest of the year, enjoy the spring, and God bless. And test everything and hold on to the good. Take it. Bye.